humans, monsters, lend me your gears.
Ow.
We're going back to antiquity with a 54 Chevy and a team of old school masters. So pick up your Monty Wrench, because I'm not lying.
Join us now as Jesse and his gang of maverick mechanics rip, grind, and burn, transforming ordinary street vehicles into monster machines in the Monster Garage. This week's challenge, turn a stock 1954 Chevy into a one-of-a-kind instant classic. The rules. For this show, we're breaking all the rules. The monster must not appear to be stock, and they'll get unlimited freebies. Jesse and his crew have 7 days and nights. The first day, they'll design. The next five, they build. And on the seventh day, they show off. If successful, the team gets a $3,400 set of Mac tools. And the sundial starts now. Jesse hammers the classic Chevy into the garage for its monster makeover. This all-steel behemoth is a remnant of a bygone era in car manufacturing. Following Jesse is a parade of one-of-a-kind originals, driven by the legends who have made them. The greatest car customizers in the world, with a combined 393 years of experience. When it comes to old school, these guys are the professors of cool. Bill the Ledslinger Hines, and he's led the pack since he started in 1941. Dick Dean, an automotive artist working in steel and a member of the National Rod and Custom Car Hall of Fame. Gene Winfield, lifetime master of perfecting new paint techniques and building eye-catching originals. Fat Jack, who wants to be called Fat Jack, the recognized king of custom chassis. John Robinson, Fat Jack's son, can craft a car from scratch. Norm El Polaco Grabowski, known as Father of the Tea Bucket, Hot Rodder, Actor, Sculptor. For this design, Tom Taylor, the premier hot rod illustrator, joins these legends of customizing as they head up to the loft to meet with Jesse.
So I got to think of something cool to call you guys besides the old timer team. This more stately. This is another theme build. They said we had to do a Roman theme. We've been thinking about this build for a while, so I figured we'd slip this in here and let you guys show all the young punks what it's like to customize a car. We haven't done a real custom car yet. I mean, we've done a lot of kind of kooky, you know, transformations, transfer one thing into another. We're going to take basically a stock 54 Chevy and make it your guys' interpretation of a custom.
Do we have to put the brush on the roof?
No.
Okay, good.
No. I think definitely we should chop it, maybe section it a little.
I'm going to cut the roof clear off, see?
That's too easy, though.
Yeah, that's
too easy.
Yeah.
So you want to section this car?
I don't know. What do you think?
Do you think you guys can do that in...
The length of time it's going to take, it's going to be... It stretches real close.
Sectioning is the process of removing a piece of the car from the middle and then sandwiching the halves back together.
I see chopping it and sectioning the hood a little bit.
The body section is rough because we have to pull everything out of the car.
I've never done it, so I say we could do it.
Great.
I say no problem. We can put the body on the lift, and we can put the chassis next to it, and then we'll section
it. These are the cheaters.
Put it back together. Then chop it.
Then chop it.
And then everything else we'll save for after those two.
So, yeah.
We're cool. I think we're cool. So.
To make their legendary custom, they'll divide the work and the car in two. The chassis will be made to ride low by changing the suspension, and fast by adding a V8 power plant. The body will become a shrine to classic cool. A 4-inch section will be excised from the Chevy's middle to lower its profile. Then the hood will be chopped to match. French headlights, custom taillights, and Bill Hines' signature sunken antennas will complete their creation, just in time to reunite it with the undercarriage. This team knows there's a Herculean task ahead of them and no time to waste, but they won't be tossing the pieces of this baby around.
Hey, no.
You saving it?
Saving him. You can't just do that.
One guy here at the shop said throw it.
Look.
Hey, John, we gotta save all that.
Son of a bitch, man.
Get out of the way so I can go to work.
Wasn't Norm on a TV show?
This is definitely not your typical build team.
I have 100% confidence level that everybody knows the job. That guy, and Bill Hines are probably four of the most famous customizers in the world. This is probably the first time ever that people are being able to see these guys in action. I've only read about it. I had Hot Wheels from Dick Dean when I was a kid that he made. I never seen him work or anything, and now we get to work side by side. I got the best job in the whole world.
Dick Dean knows this build is a bit bigger than a toy car.
It's going to be close, you know, but we all know what we're doing, so. Gene and I are going to do the section. Bill will do most of the roof. We'll do the heavy cutting for him. Because, you know, he's a little older than us.
It was natural for Dick to wind up in the family business.
My dad had a car agency, and he used to send used cars down to Bill Hines' shop to be painted. It inspired me because he was taking these old Buicks and, you know, whatever they were, and cutting the doors down on them and thinking, wow, that's interesting.
Bill was the inspiration for Dick's customizing business.
I started a company called Chalico, and I built a little car. It was called the GT Chalico. I built it in my garage. The Chalico took me to that point of being not just another body man who could modify a car, but someone who could draw a car, build it from scratch, and produce it.
When Hollywood wants a cool car, they call Dick Dean. He's done cars for the Fast and the Furious, Dick Tracy, Knight Rider, and the Hard Rock Cafe.
Okay. Let's see how much is in there.
Part of it.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say.
Jesse watches as the tear out continues and admires the team.
Usually it's like kind of, okay, go take that gas tank out. Snake eyes, damn. Car's on fire.
We're just trying to get the front end off and raise it up and get the body loose so we can get the chassis off running so we can go to work.
Fat Jack and his son John will tackle the chassis while the rest of the build team focus on the body.
This is the first build ever where everybody knows what to do.
Taylor puts up his drawing. Outside of the garage, it would take up to a year to create this car.
It's chopped and sectioned.
Even for these seasoned veterans, just chopping and sectioning this car in 5 days is going to be a challenge.
Take it away.
Thank you.
John finishes off separating the body from the chassis.
When we leave here, nice chassis is there. It won't have nothing. It won't be roller or nothing.
And they're just about ready to pop the top off this monster in the making.
That's good.
This is easy.
Hey, Tom, that's good right there.
Lift and separate.
Already did, Dean.
So we're gonna cut right through here like this, then we'll drop down, cut across here and through the center, and then we'll go down again if we have to line up with our door. Okay, let's get the paint off.
To me, this would take 6 months.
Yeah. Cardboard proves the perfect material for outlining this section to be removed. In order to get 4 inches out of the door, they split the outer skin, cut the middle out of the inner door, and cut the bottom off the outside.
This first part is called breaking the edge.
Gene Winfield's name is synonymous with breaking the mold.
In the very early years, I wanted to be different, and I realized that you could make a statement with a car, and that's what we do today. Every custom car that's built today, the owner is making a statement.
Gene first began making statements in a converted chicken house on his mother's farm. He's long since flown the coop for fancier digs and bigger cars. He's known for the creation of the fadeaway paint job.
I'm actually the one that originated the blending of paint from top to bottom. In 57 is the first car I blended complete. And I learned it all by myself. I didn't go to school for any part of the body work into it. I had to learn how to weld and everything all by myself. You know, it's a hobby, it's a life, and so that's what I do. I'm a custom car builder.
Gene smooths out the bottom part of the door's outer skin, and the door is put back together. Out in the yard, the father and son chassis team removed the antique motor. It was great in its day, but it doesn't have enough juice for a true monster classic. Now that the front end is stripped, it's time to take on the rear. An axle assembly arrives from Tube Works, custom made for the Smokin' 54.
Zero. Nada.
Fat Jack and John still have some work to do on the chassis before it's ready for action. True to Fat Jack's prediction, he and his son John have succeeded in stripping the chassis bare. It's only been one day, but these centurions of customizing have marched many leagues towards victory. They have 4 more days left to craft their chariot in the Monster Arena. Monster Garage Factoid. The top speed of a person on a camel is 8 miles an hour. In a Roman chariot, 20 miles an hour. In a stock 54 Chevy, a blazing 90 miles an hour. Day 3. Jesse's dream team arrives for their second day in the garage. They've got a lot of work to do, and these old schoolers are ready to give another lesson in customizing 101. First order of business, cutting the body in half to complete the process of sectioning started the day before. The chassis is stripped and goes out to be sandblasted. Jesse drives his Dark Angel into the garage. This week, the master fabricator is the student, and he couldn't be happier.
This is probably 60% of the history of hot rodding right here in this room right now, working, doing one car together. I don't know who to watch. I want to learn from all these guys. I don't know which guy to like team up with. How many of those have you done?
I don't know, 100. I started them in the 40s. I used to do about 6 a year. Uh-huh. I'm down to about 1 or 2
83 years young, Bill Hines has spent a lifetime turning stock into custom.
When I was 19, I took a brush, a little 37 Ford, and I painted flames with a brush on my skirts. And so that was really my first change in a car a little bit. And then I was on my way there.
For this master, every car he tackles leads him down a different road.
Sometimes I think about a car. I think about, oh, I'm going to change the front end. Or I don't even know what I'm going to do with the back end.
Everybody says I make it easy looking.
Bill still puts in a work day that would bring a young buck to his knees.
Work from about 8 o'clock until 2, 3 in the morning. You get an inspiration to do certain things. That's where it all is.
He begins the intricate process of Frenching the headlights.
I got to get this off, but this will go flat against the inside of the fender.
Frenching is the process of recessing the headlight with a rolled edge to make the body seamless. The name comes from French cuffed shirts.
See, that'll fit in from the rear, and then I'll weld it on.
With 4 inches now gone from the middle of the body, it's time to put what's left back together. The first major step in the creation of this new legend.
I knew those rear fenders were gonna look good. Close that teardrop up.
Oh yeah.
The chassis returns sandblasted and looking clean, followed by a front assembly from No Limit Engineering. And to top it off, 354 cubic inches of small block Chevy, courtesy of Wayne's Engine Rebuilding. While work continues inside the garage, Norm is out back grinding paint off the hood. He stops to give Long Beach a taste of down-home Arkansas.
Hey, Buford, are we going fishing tonight?
A man of many talents, Norm has been waiting for the right moment to show off for the boss.
This is for Jesse James.
Look at that. There's a picture of Norm. He had an old panhead in the 60s, and he has like a Mexican blanket vest on. He's drinking out of a Boda bag and like kind of a straw hat. And I remember seeing that picture when I was real young. And I'm like, man, I want to be like that. Because that was like a picture of a wild biker. And that's what it made me want to be like. I wanted to be like Norm.
Norm Grabowski is not your average hood ornament. He's led a charmed life, encompassing both cars and Hollywood.
When I first started in the movie industry, I got in there by renting the car to the studio.
He built the famous cookie car for the hit TV show 77 Sunset Strip, but that was hardly enough for this natural-born ham.
But I wanted to be in front of the camera, see?
Forget it. No good look. We make it look like an accident.
Norm went on to appear in over 50 movies and TV shows.
I like to make people laugh. You know, I like other people to be happy too.
This is why he's here. We should make a little French thing and put it right in the dash. Hey, there's that dash.
Paul from Paul's All-Pro Glass comes to the aid of the builders.
He's an expert glass man. He does every custom car that we build.
He'll recut and resize the front glass and clean and reseal the irreplaceable rear window. Dick and Gene tack weld the top and bottom halves of the section body back together. The body's now done, but before they move on and chop the top, senior team member Bill Hines has some concerns.
Well, I gotta do some thinking before you start cutting, bracing everything.
Okay.
It's too hard.
Bracing the car keeps it from warping when the top is chopped. Their final task tonight means they'll be ready to raise the roof first thing tomorrow morning.
Been working hard all day. Slashing and cutting and chopping and sparks were flying and it was
Monster Garage factoid. In Roman times, it could take as long as a month to make one chariot. In 1954, it took Chevrolet only one day to make 400 cars. Day four comes in growling like a hungry beast, but it's just Norm being normal.
I don't know what he was saying. I have no idea.
Well, we're going to chop this top.
With these pros, there's less talk and more action. The second big moment of reshaping this classic has arrived. Chopping the top, literally cutting it off in order to lower the profile. Gene, the cutting machine, then tackles the top of the roof.
Okay. Nobody will bump their head getting in the car.
John works on getting the front of the chassis ready for the engine assembly. To take the new engine's power to the rear wheels, they'll need a new transmission.
Turbo 350 VAM transmission.
Nada. John bolts the transmission onto the engine while his father prepares the chassis to accept the rear axle assembly. In order to make this legend as low as possible, they will modify the chassis by removing a 2-inch section from the rail and replace it with a 1/4-inch steel tube. Returns to top off the classic, now with its own radical new line. Post adjustments are made to keep the roof super straight.
Yeah, it's good.
Okay, let's turn the tanks off.
Okay.
It's the end of another day, and the builders head off to rest up before laying siege to their final 2 days of the build. Day five. These builders are pure old school. They know better than to predict an early victory.
Tomorrow night, about midnight, we'll finish up.
Yeah. It was a lot of work. Somehow we're going to make it. You got it. Let's
what
go
we're
to
gonna do. What we're gonna do. Yeah!
Bill preps the hood before he starts on his signature lead work.
It has to be perfectly clean.
Jesse pulls up a chair to watch the master at work.
He's tinning it right now where he puts like a coat of lead on there that's kind of, this will be like a thin film that'll go between the actual lead and the steel mixed with that flux. So when your thick layer of lead will, you know, will actually stick to that.
With $100 worth of Bondo, you could do a car where it takes you $2,000 worth of lead, oxygen, etc.
Stuff, but man, I was doing it all wrong. He's got a whole different process. I think the coolest thing about him is literally he has lead in his blood.
We got parts from total cost involved to finish out the chassis. We got the stuff to mount the rear end, the motor, the transmission, and the brake pedal assembly.
Three, zero. Nah.
nada.
John begins bolting the motor mounts to the chassis, while Gene checks out the gap where the roof meets the trunk.
And I have to put a curve. It has to curve several different directions.
In order to shape the metal, Gene uses the English wheel, the only person other than Jesse to ever work the old school tool.
It actually is it's smashing the metal, which stretches it, and then automatically goes into a curve.
John bolts the four-link suspension to the chassis. Now it's ready for airbags.
So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna cut all the glove box and everything out, and then make roll another piece, and then weld it in, and metal finish it, and it'll be all smooth, no holes, just the ignition switch and the light, and a speedo, and then chrome it, and then make this so it bolts in, it's chrome.
The engine is bolted into place, and Jesse checks on one of the troops.
You want a glass of water or anything?
Nah, my slippers and a pipe would be all right.
All right.
My dad had a torch, you know, and he played around with cars a little bit. I guess I got the disease probably from him. A lot of people like me and like what I do, and a lot of people think I'm a... I made the world's fastest hot rod out of a 46 Ford coupe. And it's chopped 7.5 inches in the front, 3.5 in the back. I do something that interests me. It's got to be bitching, it's got to be low, it's got to catch everybody's eye, and it's got to be drivable. Still doing it, still got a lot of cars to finish. And I don't think I'm going to die soon because I don't think they're through punishing me yet, you know?
John shows up with a brand new radiator from Ron Davis.
3-0. Nada.
Bill's son Mike has been in the garage all week to lend his dad any helping hand.
I've been able to watch my dad build custom cars for about the last 45 years. And I started at the shop sitting on a melt crate, sanding fender skirts that he built. I mean, these guys are legends. These guys are pioneers of building custom cars.
The team gets together for a brief end-of-the-day assessment.
When do you guys need to set this on the frame?
Oh, when the frame's ready.
Yeah, whenever it's ready. We don't need it until, you know, even tomorrow night, actually. Set it on there.
These builders are working harder than anyone has ever worked in the garage. They'll need their rest tonight because on their final day, they still need to get the body back on the chassis, attach the doors, the trunk, and the hood. And Bill has to complete his signature French antennas, or this build will end up in ruins.
Okay, Monster Makers, the race is on. Will Bill Hines, a.k.a. the Lead Slinger, finish his cigar before Jesse and the gang finish the 54?
Let's just section the fenders and put it on there and see how it sits on the ground. Yeah.
Stick around for some monster mayhem.
Day 6, the final build day.
Fresh day, fresh start, feel good. I think we're gonna, you know, get right after it.
With so much to do, there's only one way to make it.
A sprint to the end?
Yeah.
You better believe it. We're gonna be sprinting.
Gene and Dick start on the doors.
We're gonna hem this over and take the top of the door off so we can stick it in the hole.
Hemming the bottom of the door creates a lip, ensuring a tight fit.
about where it goes.
They bolt them back on.
Okay, I got two of them started.
Bill's busy prepping his distinctive dual aerials.
I'm setting up the aerials so I can put them in after a while. It takes about 2 hours on the aerial.
Norm is injured. And Brian Lind, the Monster Garage EMT, patches him up.
I was walking through here, and I didn't realize that thing sticking up so high. My shin caught it. It cut it, I guess, pretty good. You can see the little bit of blood.
The laceration went under the skin and clipped the skin up. You're probably going to need some stitches.
Well, you know, when they say Monster Garage, they're not kidding.
John gets a critical engine part.
It's a 650 Mighty Demon carburetor.
3-0. Nada.
Gene creates a new back deck for the reshaped area where the trunk meets the roof. Then goes to work on the roof itself. He drills a hole to put in rivets, connecting the two pieces of the roof where a section was removed.
They hold the two pieces of metal together so we can weld between them without warping the metal too much.
Gene hammer welds the finished seam.
But the real art of the hammer welding is not just hammering the weld, but it's controlling the surface around it. That's what I'm doing, is I'm controlling this, all this surface around here by working it after I hammer it. Put the rod like that. It's got the contour right there.
That looks pretty damn good.
Thank you.
Norm returns from getting patched up.
Hi, Norman.
23 stitches.
Wow. Feel like a reenactment?
Like the fall of Rome, Jesse tries his hand at reenacting Norm's fall.
Oh, Lord, Jesus. Was it like that?
Yeah, pretty much.
Okay.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, that's about right. Yeah.
To create a place of honor for the numbskull Normskull, Jesse cuts a cardboard template before setting it in place. There's not much that will get Norm up off his throne, but Jesse insists.
I like how he's kind of looking over at the chick.
Yeah, I like that too.
He's like checking her out.
Yeah.
Despite being a man short, this team of hardworking veterans presses on. Mike admires his father's drive.
But he has some goals, and his goals is to build cars till he's 88. So he's got 6 more years and about 1,000 cigars.
This is tedious.
Bill has tried to teach others to do what he does. It's just not that easy.
I was a young kid when he taught me how to do this. I watched him do it, and then he says, okay, now you got to do it. How the hell do you do that?
How'd you do?
I finally advanced to, capable.
Getting in that radius in there?
I caught a special disc to get in there.
That's kind of cool.
Yeah.
It works. I'm going to have to try that.
Yeah,
that's pretty cool.
Jesse and Gene assessed the status of the build.
Well, let's just section the fenders and put it on there and see how it sits on the ground. Back. Yeah.
Okay.
And then that's right. And then we'll put the body on and then see go from there.
Okay. Cool.
Well, we cut 4 inches off the bottom of the fenders and we're re-radiusing the bottoms.
I gotta cut the other side though while I'm hot.
Okay, while you're hot, go.
It takes a bit of fine-tuning with a torch to get the hood right so it'll fit on the reshaped body.
Set it down.
You know what? The inner wheel wells are hitting a firewall. When it starts to go back, that hits
the firewall, right?
Yeah. So we just, I'd blow the wheel wells out of it, make a new set for it. You want to just tip the nose up right here?
Of course.
Sure.
Move the crate.
Like that.
Let's just blow them out of the way.
John finishes up the chassis. It's now ready to receive the newly chopped and sectioned body. Mike muscles over the trunk lid.
We'll bring the body on and then put the front end on it.
Okay.
There's enough of us. We should be able to muscle it.
All right.
It's getting closer to midnight, and it's now or never for this team of legends. Time to see if the chopped and sectioned body will fit onto the upgraded chassis.
I think the rear end's bottoming out on the... Oh. Yeah.
See right here, Jesse.
Okay. I'm gonna trim it.
A few further trims.
Yeah. Straight up and then forward like an inch and a half.
Ooh, that felt good.
And now for the final touch. They lift the front end into place.
I guess it was enough. What do you think?
Paul the glass man returns and places the front and rear pieces perfectly into place.
Sectioned up. I like it. I've never seen one before, so that's kind of cool.
See, the whole car's going uphill a little bit.
That's good. That section looks right on that body.
Yes, absolutely. I love it. I think it's fantastic.
You can do the backs, wave flip fender flares.
Well, I
60 think style. Come on.
I have moldings and skirts on
there. Where's that steering wheel? Look cool, man.
That looks a little big. That feels pretty low.
After all this hard work, the beauty of this classic car transformed into a custom legend begins to sink in.
I think it's a chopped and sectioned 54 Chevy. That's what I think. That's pretty cool, huh?
You bet.
Weary but happy, the builders march to meet Emperor Jesse.
Got Monster Garage CDs.
Cool.
Mac Tools.
Okay. Cool.
Where did you want Lawrence Welk instead?
I don't think so. All right. All right.
Like Samson.
I thought you fell off a toolbox.
All right, let's get the hell out of here.
Down at Hot Rods and Hobbies, Scott and his team take on the mudwork, or Bondo, and prime the car. They're getting it ready to head off to Gene Winfield's for his signature paint job.
Next step after this, we're going to some primer. Before Bondo, after Bondo on the other side.
Build cost tally. Vehicle cost, $6,000. Freebie value, $14,193. Parts total, $3,167. Total vehicle cost, $23,360. But with this build team, priceless.
Okay, everybody, Full Big Swag reporting to you from the Monster Front. This latest challenge is brought to you by the City of Long Beach, the eternal home of Monster Garage. Wolf 54 is out, but it's not done yet. She's been torched and welded, scraped and shaped, and banged and bondoed. The only way to finish this baby off? Hand it over to builder Gene Winfield for one of his custom paint jobs. You gotta be kidding me. When this dude is done, there'll be only one 54 Chevy like this in the whole damn world. Nice job, Gene. It looks like a tequila sunrise made out of molded metal. Bartender, I'll have another. Before we hit the road, let's take a good look at the prettiest thing to ever come out of the Monster Garage. Check out the chrome dashboard. Oh, there's the Norm Skull. Do we like the classic white and gold interior, courtesy of Stitchcraft? Of course we do. Okay, folks, the moment we've all been waiting for. Say hello to the 54 Monster Chevy. It was built by legends in the business, and they've teamed up again to help Jesse usher the 54 out into the world. Life is good, is it not, Mr. Jesse James?
You get that? I get the best job in the whole world. I get to build, like, stuff like that and just drive it around. I love to make stuff, and I get paid to make stuff like that, and I get to work with, like, the best hot rodders in the world ever.
Long Beach has never seen a parade like this, led by a car destined to turn heads for years to come. Team 54, Monster Garage salutes you. Okay, it's time to park it and hear from a man.
That thing looks good.
Beautiful, man.
You, like, look at a good-looking woman, and you, like, you kind of look at him, you're like, oh, I wonder what her problem is. But that car you look at, and you're just like, man, and, like, it's like a magnet for me.
What about the guys who built it?
I think with Bill and Gene and Dick and Jack and Norm and all these guys working on it, it's kind of their tribute to what they do. You know, they're showing a lot of kids, including myself, how it's done.
Gotta get a picture of it too. There you go.
Enough. The 54 needs to get some beauty rest. Jesse's got no time for classic Chevys that aren't sectioned, chopped, or dropped. He's got metal to burn, sparks to fly, the next Monster Garage Challenge